And so in the previous lecture, we looked at distributing over some expression. And now we're going to do the reverse of that. We are going to factor expressions. So we're going to start with an expression and we're going to break it down into its constituent factors. So our discussion is going to be all about factoring. So last time, as mentioned, we talked about expanding. So we would have certain expressions that we want to expand. This is just the reverse of that. We want to factor. We want to go from something that we've expanded by using distribution. We want to now break it apart into its constituent parts again. So let's put a little line right under factoring. And the first thing that we are going to talk about is we're going to talk about polynomials. So let's just define what a polynomial is, and I'm going to write out a polynomial just in terms of variables. So there are many ways that you can write this, but let's have a subscript n, and then we're going to have x to the power n plus, now I'm going to just decrease this n by 1, so n minus 1, so that I have x to the power n minus 1 as well, plus we're going to go a and then the subscript 2 minus 1, and then x to the power n minus 2. And then we're going to go all the way, and so there's our little ellipses, as we've had before, and then I'm going to have a sub 2 x squared plus a sub 1 x to the power 1, and we usually don't put that. And lastly, we have a sub 0, and we have x to the power 0, which is 1, so we leave it there. So that's an odd sort of notation. One thing that we do always want to have is that a sub n is not equal to 0. So we have these little subscripts just to denote the fact that these are different values. These are different variables. And because we're using a all the time and we run out of letters for the alphabet, it's a very easy thing just to put subscripts there just to denote that that is a different number from that, or at least a different variable, a different variable, a different variable, a different variable. The x remains the same, that's the same variable, and we're just raising it to a certain power. So if we start right at the back, that would be x to the power 0, x to the power 1, x squared, all the way, and you can count up until you get to x to the power n. So let's have a little example. So let's have an example. Let's say 3x to the power 4 plus 2x to the power 3 plus, let's have x squared, let's have plus 2x, let's have plus 4. And now you can see what's happening here. Here is my a sub 0 value. That's just 4. There's my a sub 1, which is 2. My a sub 2, which is just 1. So a sub 1 is 2. A sub 2 is 1. Here's a sub 3. That's a 2. And there's a sub 4, which is 3. And then I just have corresponding to these subscripts. And remember, that does nothing to the number. That's just denoting that these are all different values. Later on, we'll call them coefficients. We'll have a look at that. But that just corresponds to the power that we raise the variable by. So that'll be an example of a polynomial. And usually we write this descending order of this variable x. And we do like this first coefficient, a sub n. In this instance, that would be a sub 4, not to be equal to 0. If that was 0, this term doesn't really exist because 0 times anything is just 0. And then we just would have started right there at the a sub 3. So that's important for us to know. And so the subscript notation, I, that's really what we call, call it a counter. In this instance, we started counting at 0 and 1, 2, 3, and we go all the way up to n. And that's just a counter that we, you know, helps us keep track of these things, but it just denotes these different values. So let's just define this idea of a coefficient. So coefficient is this constant that goes in front of the variable that we're raising to a certain power. So all the a sub 4, a sub 3, a sub 2, a sub 1, or you know, whatever my n value is, just in decreasing order. You can, of course, just write it the other way around if I wanted to. You'll see many different ways, as I mentioned. But these are all our coefficients. And we usually use a or b or c, something to that order, denoting that these will be constant values. And that is the way that we denote them. And those are just those coefficients. I'm going to call them a sub I and that's why I wrote the I there. These are all my I's. Now I say n minus 1 n, but I just means it's this counter that we're talking about. This little counter at the bottom, the subscript, does nothing to what the number really is. Just denoting that I can be 0, there's a 0. We're denoting I can be 1, there's my a sub 1, which in this instance is a 2, etc. So those are just going to be my coefficients. We define something called the degree. Of the polynomial. By the way, let's just keep track of all of these. There is where I defined my polynomial. So let's keep that one in green. And here is where I defined what a coefficient is. So please keep track of that one for me. Now we're going to be talking about the degree of a polynomial. So let's say degree of a polynomial. And so by degree of a polynomial, what we mean is we definitely have to have that a subscript n is not equal to 0. Then n is the degree of the polynomial. And so let's look at an example very quickly. Let's go back to this example where we had 3x to the power 4 plus 2x to the power 3 plus x squared plus 2x plus 4. And indeed, there's my n. That is the highest power that we went to as far as the variable's power is concerned. Here we had x to the power 0, that's just 1. Here we had x to the power 1, x squared, x cubed, x to the power 4. So the degree of this polynomial is equal to 4. It's a fourth degree polynomial. So let's put another little green marker there. We have defined something called the degree of a polynomial. Now there's a couple of polynomials of various degrees that we give names to. And so the first one that we have is called the quadratic polynomial. So let's write that. Quadratic polynomial. And let's make a column just for the degrees. That's a polynomial that's of degree 2. So we have something like x squared plus 4x plus 3. Next thing we're going to have a cubic polynomial. And that will be of degree 3, and something like, let's put 2x cubed plus 4x squared minus 3x plus 2. We also get a higher order quartic, a quartic polynomial, so quadratic, even though it says quad, we don't mean 4 by that. A quartic is degree 4, and something like, let's make it x to the power 4 minus 3. Now, can I have that? Yes. Because what we are saying in this instance is that x to the power 3 has a coefficient of 0. X to the power 2 has a coefficient of 0. And then x has a coefficient of 0. And then x to the power 0 has its coefficient 3. That's still the highest power that we have there, and that makes it a fourth order. Then we also get a quintic. And there are names for higher order, but I think we can just stop there. That'll be a polynomial of order 4, and so let's make it 3 to the power 5, I should say, x to the power 5 plus, now let me do this, let me write 0x to the power 4 plus 0x to the power 3 plus, let's make it x squared minus x plus 2, and you can see those will be 0, so this will just be equal to 3x to the power 5 plus x squared minus x plus 2. And so you needn't have these other powers because their coefficient might be 0, as long as this what we call a leading coefficient. So this is going to be my leading coefficient. Let's put a line there. That's called my leading coefficient. Now that leading coefficient, as long as that is not equal to 0, in this instance, in this example, that'd be a sub 5, that that's not equal to 0. If that was 0, that would be 0, that would be 0, and we'd end up right there. That'll be a second degree polynomial. So it is the highest of these powers of our variable as long as the coefficient is not equal to 0. And the leading is going to be that one that's attached to the variable that is raised to the highest power. So let's just make that another little definition of ours. Now we're going to start factoring. Now that we have our definitions out of the way, let's factor something that are, you know, fairly common to do. Let's say factor common elements. So what is common about certain terms in an expression? Common elements. And so we're going to start with something very simple, and we're going to start with something we learned last week, distribution. So imagine I had x, and I multiplied that by x minus 3. Now, by distribution, that's going to be x times x and x times x minus 3. So let's have a look at that. That's going to be x times x, which means x times x plus the x times the negative 3. So there'll be a negative 3 actually times the x. That's a 1. That's a 1. I'm multiplying. The bases are the same. I can add those two. X 1 plus 1. And then the positive times the negative would be negative 3x. And this would just be x squared minus 3x. So just a little simple revision of last week. So this is going to be x times x minus 3. And what we mean by factoring is instead of going in this direction, we're now going to go in this direction. We're going to go from x squared minus 3x to its component terms, you could say here, or at least these parts of this expression. So there's one part of it and there's the second part. So we are factoring it. These are two factors of our expression here. This expression has two terms, and if we factorize it, we end up with these two factors. And so we're just going to go in reverse. So how would we go about if we are given this example problem? Let's do the example problem. Let's say we have x squared minus 3x, and we want to factorize it. And as I say, this example is something about common elements. What is common between these terms in this expression? And so let's just rewrite it as we had it right there. That would be x times x minus 3 times x. So if I look at these two different terms in this expression, what is common to both of them? Well, there is certainly an x there, and there's an x there. This x here does not have a counterpart in this term. There's only a single x there. So if I look at what is common between these two, there's only a single x that is common between these two. And we say we take out that x. This is a common term that we use. We take out that x. We factor that x out. What is left? Well, if I've taken this one out, all that is left is here is an x. If I took that one out, all that is left there is a negative 3. And now I've gone from this expression with its two terms, and I have factorized it into its two factors. Those are the two components that make up this expression. And that is what we mean by taking out or factoring out a common element. Here, x was a common element between these two. Now, let's look at another example, because it's not always the variable that is the common factor. Sometimes it's the constant that's a common factor. So let's look at this example. I have 6x squared plus 9y. Let's factorize that. But first of all, let's just write it out in its constituent parts. Now, remember we said that every integer is the product of prime numbers. So let's have a look quickly at 6. I'm going to divide it by its smallest, the smallest prime, which is 2. And 2 indeed does divide 6. Divides, what we mean by that is there is no remainder. If I say 6 divided by 2, that's equal to 3, and the remainder is 0. So 2, now I've got a 3 left, and 3 is a prime, and so that is it. 6 would be equal to 2 times 3. Those are both primes, and that is prime factorization of the number 6. Let's look at 9. We cannot divide 2 into 9 because that'll be 4 with a remainder of 1. So that doesn't work. The next smallest prime is 3. That's great. If I say 9 divided by 3, I've got 3 left. Now I'm going to divide 3 by the smallest prime, which is 2. Doesn't work. Next smallest prime is 3. Yes, it does divide. 3 does divide 3 without a remainder. And there we see the prime factorization of 6 and 9. And now if I bring these down, let's have a look at these. What is the only common factor? So remember, if I brought these down, we'll have the least common multiple, but that's not what we want to do here. We want to know what is common between these two. And certainly if I look here, let's draw a little box here. It is the 3 is the only thing that is common among these two. So 3 would be a common factor. Just as we factorize this expression here, we factorize this expression. Here we're factorizing the constants, and the only common one between them would be the 3. So I can definitely factor out a 3. Now look, there's two x's and there's a y. There's nothing common between those two terms as far as x's and y are concerned, so there's nothing I can take out. So that would be it. So if I say 6 divided by 3, well, there's a remainder of, or there, it goes in, 3 goes into 6 twice, there's no remainder. And then I have x squared, and it goes into 9 3 times, so I'll have plus 3y. And now I factored this expression into its factors. The only common factor that I can take out between 6x squared and 9y is the 3. That's the only thing that's common between those two terms. So as I mentioned, that we can also think about constants, not only variables, that can be taken out as common factor. Now let's have a look at a much nicer example, because that'll bring everything home. 216, let's make 216x plus, let's make it 450y. And now, can I factorize this? Now, first of all, we have to think, let's think about the variables. There's an x here and a y there. There's nothing common as far as the variables are concerned between those two. So again, we're left with the two constants. So can we think about prime factorization as far as these two are concerned? So there are a couple of laws, and you can see them if you do look at the notes, the description to the notes that would be available down in the description. You can look at those notes, and there's a couple of laws here. The easiest one to look at is to say that if we take the largest number divided by the smallest number and we look at the remainder of that division, then we're going to look at only the remainder and the smallest of those two numbers. The remainder and the smallest of those two numbers. So that's a very easy way, a nice way to go about that. And let's just do a little bit of long division. Now this is, of course, just reviewing algebra. We're not going to do much arithmetic here, so let's just remind ourselves how to do long division. So that's 450 divided by 216. And if we do this long division, what is left? Well, first of all, let's look at 216 in 450. That does not really go. It does not go into 4, it doesn't go into 45, but it does go into 450, and it goes into 450 exactly twice. So 6 times 2 is 12, I carry the 1, 2 times 1 is 2, plus the 1 would be a 3, and 2 times 2 is 4, and now I'm going to do subtraction, and here we go, I'm going to borrow there, so that becomes a 4, that becomes a 10, so I'm left with 8, and I've borrowed there, so that becomes a 1, and I have a remainder of 18, so we can say 450 divided by 216, that is going to equal 2, with a remainder of 18. And now we say the following. If we look at these common multiples that we can take out, and we're going to call those the largest of these common multiples that we can take out, we're going to talk about this remainder and the smallest of these two numbers. So there's my remainder is 18. Let's do prime factorization of that 18. Can it divide 2? Yes, it can. That's the smallest prime. That leaves me with a 9. Can 9 be divided by 2? No. What's the next prime is 3? Yes, it can be divided by 3. So there's my 3. I've got 3 left. Can it be divided by 2? No. Next prime is 3. Yes, it can be divided by 3. So that's what I have. 18, if I do prime factorization, that'll be 2 times 3 times 3. 2 times 3 is 6, 6 times 3 is 18. There we go. Let's look at 216. That's going to be a little bit more difficult. Can it divide 2? Yes, it can. If I divide it by 2, what do I have left? 108. Can 108 be divided by 2? Yes, it can. And if I divide it by 2, I am left with 108 divided by 2. That'll be 54. Can 54 be divided by 2? Yes, it can. So there's another 2. There's another 2, and now I'm left with 27. 27, on the other hand, can be divided into 3, and that leaves me with 9, which is 3 times 3. And there we have this prime factorization of 216. Now, what I want to do is I just want to write this in a slightly better way. Let's do a 2 and a 3 and a 3. And so here I'm going to have a 2 and a 2 and a 2. and a 3, and a 3, and a 3. There we go. That was the prime factorization of 18. That was the prime factorization of 216. And let's look at what is common between these two. If I wrote it in nice columns, look at this. We have that 2 is common there. We have that there's 1 3 that is common. We have another 3 that is common. And that's it. This 2 does not have a mate, this one doesn't have, and that 3 doesn't have. So we've got 2 times 3 times 3. And 2 times 3 is 6, 6 times 3 is 18. So indeed, 18 is common to both of these. It is common to both of these. We call that the greatest common divisor. So if I take 18 and I divide it by 216, I take 18 divided by 450, that is going to be the largest of all the numbers, all the possible numbers that I can get that will divide both 216 and 450. So let's do 216, and I'm going to divide that into 18, I'm going to divide 18 into 216. And you can do your long division or use a calculator, you'll see that is 12. And if I take 18 and I divide it into 450, if I divide it into 450, I'm going to get 25. So use your calculator and see that that happens. So see, there's no remainder with these. There's absolutely no remainder. And so by doing this prime factorization, writing things neatly in order, I can just see what is common amongst those two. And if I multiply that out, that is going to give me something called the greatest common divisor. That's the greatest number that divides both of those. And so if you can read the notes and you can go through one of these techniques that gives us this number. So 18 is going to be my common factor. And I know that is going to be 12 times x plus 25 times y. And that is the only way that I can properly factor 216x plus 450y is discovering this greatest common divisor, the greatest number that will divide both 216 and 450. And as I say, if you want to do this by hand and not use something like Python to do this for you, which is very, very easy, this is the way that I would go about it. Take the smallest number divided into the biggest number, so 450 divided by 216, and look at what the remainder is. Now you're going to take the smallest of these two numbers and the remainder, and you're going to do, between those two, you're going to do prime factorization. And then you're going to see what is common between those two. There's a 2 that is common, but there's no 2 there, there's no 2 there. There's 1 3, 1 3, but there's no 3 there. So these were the only common values. You multiply them out, you're going to get 18, and that is the greatest common divisor of 216 and 450. Let's continue our discussion. We're going to do one more example. Now, this example is going to be easier because, as I mentioned, the last one was kind of the most difficult one you will get when you want to factorize or at least get the greatest common divisor of two integers. And the larger they get, I really want to suggest that you take a look at the Python videos and learn how to do that using a computer language. It's just so much easier. So let's do this one. Let's have 6x squared plus 9 times x times y. We want to factor those. So let's factor each of these. 6, when we do prime factorization, would be 2 times 3. That's a prime. 2 times 3 is 6. I can't factor this any further. X squared can be factored. I can write x times x. And then I have a plus there. 9 can be factored into 3 times 3. That's the prime factorization of 9. Then I have a times x and I have a times y. Let's look at what is common between these two terms. There's a 2 on this side. There's no 2 there. There's a single 3 there. There's a 3 there. There's an x here and there's an x there. But there's no other x. If I look at this 3, yes, it has its corresponding 3 on this side, but the other 3 doesn't have a partner on the side. There's the x's, they have a partner, but this y doesn't have a partner. So what is common between those two are the 3 and the x, and I can take those out as my common factor. What is left behind? Well, if I've taken the 3 and the x out, the 3 and the x, what is left on this side? Well, 2 times x. 2 times x, and here we have 3 times y, 3 times y, and we have factorized. Now once again, if you do distribution, you're just going to get back 6x squared plus 9xy. So you can always check your work. And so those would be examples of just taking a common factor and factoring that out of an expression. Now the next thing I want to talk to you about is factoring. So let's write factoring. Let's do quadratic expressions. In quadratics, those are second order polynomials. So let's have a sub 2x squared plus a sub 1x. And remember, there's a little one there, and a sub 0, and there's an x sub 0, but that's just 1. And we also have to have that a sub n is not equal to 0. And by a sub n here, we mean the 2, a sub 2. If that was 0, then this term would fall away and then be a first order polynomial. But it's a second order polynomial because this a sub n, which is a sub 2 in our instance for quadratic equations or second order polynomials, would, you can't have that 0. So let's consider an example. So we want to factor the following. Let's have x squared plus, let's do 5x, and let's do plus 6. So what do we have here? It's second order. My a sub 2, which is right there, or a sub n, right there, that's just equal to 1. So it's not 0. I have my variable, the highest power would be, there's also an x sub 0 there, remember, would be 2. This makes it a second order polynomial or a quadratic expression. Now, quadratic expressions, they are always going to have two factors. And because we do distribution, that'll be an x and that'll be an x. And we just have to figure out which number goes here and which number goes there. And through distribution, I mean, x times x is x squared, so we're going to have the x squared there. But if I have a look at this constant times that constant, I better get to 6. So how can I get 6? If I multiply two numbers, because I'm going to have that number multiplied by that number, how can I get a 6? Well, let's have a look. I can do 6 times 1. I can do negative 6 times negative 1. I can do 1 times 6. I can do negative 1 times negative 6. I can do 2 times 3. I can do negative 2 times negative 3. I can do 3 times 2. And I can do negative 3 times negative 2. All of those will give me 6. So this is not prime factorization. I'm just looking at, if I multiply two integers, how do I get to 6? Well, those would be the integers that I can multiply with each other to give me 6. And so let's see if we plug these in on this side, whether we get to this expression. So let's try plus 6 and plus 1. Because I'm going to get x squared there, and I'm going to get plus 6 there. But what about this 5x? So what we have to consider is those multiplications, that distribution. So here I'm going to get x plus 6x, and that equals 7x, and that's not what I want. I want 5x. So I know I can remove this one from my list of possibilities. Now, exactly the same thing, think about it, is going to happen if I have negative 6 and negative 1. If I have negative 6 and negative 1, I'm still going to have 6 at the end. Negative 6 times negative 1 gives me positive 6, but I'm going to have negative 6x and negative 1x, which is going to give me negative 7x. That one's also not going to work. And the same is going to apply to those two. And so let's start with the 2 by 3s. Let's have a look at those. And I'm going to still have an x there. I'm going to have an x there. And let's have a look. Let's start with 2 and 3. So I'm going to have positive 2 and positive 3. Now, I'm still going to have x times x is x squared. So I get that one. I have 2 times 3, which is 6. So let's look at multiplying these two. So I'm going to have x times 3. That's going to be 3x. And 2 times x, that's going to be positive 2x. And lo and behold, if I add 3 apples and another 2 apples, I get 5 apples. And that's exactly what I want. And so x plus 2 and x plus 3 is going to be the factorization of that second order polynomial. And you can check on that. Now, look at these, the way that I've, done my distributions. But remember, we usually do it this way, those two and these two, but that's the same as doing it this way around. Nothing, that's no different, those two ways of thinking about it. So I'm still going to have x squared plus x times 3, that's 3x. And here 2 plus x, 2 times x, that's positive 2x. And then 2 times 3, which is 6. So there, right there in the middle, I still have my 3x and 2x. So it doesn't matter which way around I do this, I still get the same solution. And that gives me 5x, which is exactly what I want. So this was going to be the selection. And by the way, 2 and 3 and 3 and 2, whether I put the 3 and the 3 there and the 2 there, that was also going to work for me. We have the commutative property of multiplication, so I could have x plus 2 times x plus 3 or x plus 3 times x plus 2. So this one was also going to work for me. Let's do another one. The more of these you do, as always, the better it's going to be for you. Mathematics is not a spectator sport, it's a participation sport. Let's do x squared minus, minus 6. And so it is a polynomial. I'm going to have two factors, and the first ones are going to be x times x to get me x squared. Now I just have to think how to get negative 6. What do I multiply to give me negative 6? Well, this time around, let's start with saying negative 6 times positive 1, or 6 times negative 1, or negative 1 times 6, or 1 times negative 6. And then I can also have negative 2 times 3, or 2 times negative 3. I can get 3 times 2, and I can also, well, that's going to be, let's make this negative 3 times 2 and 3 times negative 2. All these 8 multiplications are all going to give me negative 6. So let's start with that very first one. Let's do a negative 6, and there a positive 1, positive 1. So let's have a look at this. Again, remember, I'm going to get my x squared here, and I'm going to get my negative 6 from there. Let's see what happens with these two. X times positive 1, that's going to give me x. And here I'm going to have negative 6x minus 6x. That gives me minus 5x. That equals minus 5x. That's not what I want. I want a negative x. So surely this first one does not work at all. That one does not work at all. And let's think about some of the others. Which ones are going to work for us? Well, let's try the second one. Let's try a 6, a positive 6, and a negative 1. Do you think that one's going to work? If I have positive 6, I'm going to have a positive 6x minus x. That's going to give me positive 6 minus 1. That gives me a positive 5x. It's certainly still not what I want. And you can work through all of these, the 6 times 1s with the different signs. None of them are going to work. Let's try this one, negative 2 and 3. So let's go for this one, x and an x. Let's try negative 2 and positive 3. Now you can immediately see that's not going to work. We need a negative 1. And if we look at this, if we have positive 3x minus 2x, that leaves us with a positive x. That's not what we want. So this one's not going to work either. And the one that's going to obviously work is this one. Let's have a look at that one. Let's do x plus 2 and x minus 3. Now, let's just do our normal distribution. And let's go straight for that. And you'll see it does work indeed. So x times x would be x squared. I have negative 3x. That's the x times the negative 3. 2 times x is positive 2x. And as we had plus 2 times negative 3, that is going to give us negative 6. So we do have our x squared and we do have our negative 6. That's where we always start. It's about this middle term. And indeed, negative 3x, positive 2x gives me negative x. And I have x squared minus x minus 6, which is exactly my problem. And so this would be the correct one. That would definitely be the correct one. Now, of course, there is commutativity, so I could also have x minus 3, x plus 2. But Sydney, you just need to write it in one of the solutions here, and that absolutely works. So if you look carefully, we have the two factors. We have x and x. Then we think about this value here. That would be our a sub 0 in this instance would be a negative 6. Yeah, our a sub 0 was positive 6. And we just have to think, how can we get that? That gives us these last two terms. But there's many ways to get negative 6. Many multiplication of two integers is going to give me negative 6. And I have to choose the right combination such that if I think about these two terms, the outside and the inside distribution, that if I add them, that I get what I want, which in this instance was a negative 1. Now, I need not have that my leading coefficient is equal to just 1. Let's have a look at this example. I'm going to have 2x squared plus 7x plus 3. Now, that is a wholly different beast in as much as my leading coefficient here is not equal to 1. This is still a second order polynomial or quadratic expression. And so let's see if we can factor this. We know this is a polynomial, so we're going to definitely have two terms. But now I have to get 2x. When I multiply these first two terms, when I multiply these two terms, I must get 2x squared. So certainly this has to be a 2x, and that one is an x, such that if I do that multiplication, I get, I did 2x squared, which is 2x squared. Now I have to think, how can I get positive 3? Positive 3 would be my a sub 0 term as positive 3. So let's think how we can get this. We can get this as 3 times 1. We can get this as negative 3 times negative 1. We can get this as 1 times 3. We can get this as negative 1 times negative 3. So certainly as far as integers go, that would be the multiplication. Now it's not always going to work out like this. We might, you know, get fractions that we need to consider, but those would be more advanced cases. In this lecture, we're only thinking about, you know, a systematic way of going about factoring these polynomial expressions. So let's start with this first one. That would be a positive 3 and a positive 1. So positive 3 and a positive 1. And so if I do this multiplication there, this distribution 3 times 1 gives me a positive 3. That's correct. And the 2x times x gives me the 2x squared. Let's have a look at what happens to my inner term if I do that distribution. So 2x times positive 1, that's going to give me 2x, plus 3x plus 3x, that gives me 5x. And definitely that is not going to work for me. The 3 times 1, let's remove it. That is not going to work. So let's choose negative 3 and negative 1. So I'll go through the motions. I'm going to get 2x there, and I'm going to get an x there. Let's go negative 3 and negative 1. So I'm definitely going to get the first term, and I'm definitely going to get the last term. That's how I set it up. So I'm going to get 2x squared, and I'm going to get a positive 3. So let's look at this middle term. I'm going to get 2x times negative 1. That's negative 2x. And negative 3 times x, that gives me negative 3x, and that gives me negative 5x, and that's not what I want. I want positive 7x. So definitely those two were not going to work. Let's have a look at this next on my list. I've still got my 2x, and I've still got my x, and now I've got positive 1 and positive 3. Now again, 2x times x is going to give me 2x squared. The 1 times 3 is going to give me 3. So I certainly do have the first term and the last term. Let's again look at this middle term. Here I'm going to have 6x plus 1x gives me 7x. 6x plus 1x, that equals 7x. And that's exactly what I want, the 7x. So my solution is indeed 2x plus 1 times x plus 3. And you can go about that just in the way that we've always gone about it when we do this distribution. But doing it this way or this way is exactly the same. You're going to get 2x squared plus 6x plus 1x plus 3. And the 6x plus 1x gives me a 7x. So I'm going to get 2x squared plus 7x plus 3. And I've got the right solution. There is my factorization of this quadratic expression. As I said before, we definitely cannot get enough of these. So let's do another example. I'm going to do 2x squared minus 5x minus 12. Now again, that's a more difficult one because I don't have a leading coefficient that is 1. It's still a second order polynomial or quadratic expression. So I know that I'm going to get these two terms. And there's my two terms. Now I have to think about, how do I get negative 12? Now, there are many ways to get negative 12. And you've got to start, I think, after doing quite a few of these, start doing this in your head. And you've got to think, if there are two things that I multiply by each other to get 12, which one of those pairs is going to get me close to a negative 5? And certainly if I think about 6 and 2, well, 6 and 2, 6 times 2 is 12, but the difference between 6 and a 2 is a 4, so that's not going to really help. That's not really going to help me. What if I think about a 3 and a 4? Now, I have to remember that I also have to bring this 2 into it. And that's what makes life very difficult. I'm starting to think, though, that if I mix a 3 and a 4, a 3, let's think about it, 3 and a 4, but I've also got to multiply one of them by a 2, and if I multiply this by a 2, I get 8. And from 8 and 3, yes, if I could get 8, a negative 8 and a positive 3, that'll give me 2, 5. So I think the 3 and the 4s are perhaps going to work for me. So to get negative 12, let's think about it. The first thing that I can think about is 3 times negative 4. Let's try those ones. Positive 3 and negative 4. Now that's exactly what I had in mind, because I said there's my 8 and there's my 3, and there is a way to use 8 and 3 to get to 5, especially negative 5, if I had a negative 8 and a positive 5, that is going to, a positive 3, that's going to give me a negative 5. And there I have my negative 8 and my positive 3. There we go, negative 8x, positive 3x is going to give me negative 5x. So this is absolutely the solution. So let's have a look at that, just to make sure that that works. 2x times x is going to give me 2x squared. And now I'm going to have the negative 8x, I'm going to have the positive 3x, and I'm going to have the negative 12. So I'm going to have 2x squared minus 5x minus 12. So you have to start thinking in your head, you know, how can I get close to negative 5? What of these numbers, if I have a 2 there and I'm thinking of getting negative 12, what of the numbers that I multiply to give me negative 12 can I possibly use to get me to a negative 5? And the 6 and the 2 wasn't really going to work for me, but definitely the 3 and the 4, if I could get to this stage, as I mentioned. Now, you can still write out all of the ways that you can get to negative 12, and you can go through all of them. But after you've done a few of these, I want you just to start thinking it through in your head without having to write down all the possible values. In the beginning, though, please write them all out. Let's do one more example, and let's make this one, let's make it 40x squared. Let's do minus 40x, let's do minus 240. And that's still a second order polynomial, degree 2 polynomial or quadratic expression. My leading coefficient here is not 0, and the highest power of my variable x is 2. And what I can see here is immediately that I can factor out one of these. I can factor out, you know, looking at these coefficients, a 40, a negative 40, and a 240. What if I do it just to take 40 out as a common factor? I am left with x squared minus x and minus 6. X squared minus x minus 6. If I were to distribute 40 into this expression here, I'm definitely going to get 40x squared minus 40x minus 240. And now all that is left is x squared minus x minus 6. We have seen that before. We're going to get 40. There's going to be my x term. There's going to be an x. Now I just have to think, how can I get to negative 6 such that I can think of getting to a negative 1? And certainly that is going to be a negative 3 and a positive 2. That's going to give me the negative 6, but negative 3x, positive 2x gives me negative x. And that was a simple, simple example where you just have to think about first simplifying your polynomial by looking at what is common common amongst these coefficients, and we're looking for the greatest common divisor. So 40 goes into 40 once, 40 goes into 40 once, and 40 goes into 240 six times, and I just have to remember what the signs are. Now that is very exciting, but now let's move on to building, you know, the building blocks. In a later chapter, we're going to build on what we have now. But I want to talk to you about the difference between squares. And so we talk about these as perfect squares, and what we have is x squared minus a squared. And that's a square, and that's a square and a difference. Now remember, what we are talking about here is ax squared plus, let's do bx plus c. Before I did a sub 2 x squared plus a sub 1 x sub, you know, to the power 1 plus a sub 0. But you may also see this in the textbook. So a sub 2 is just a sub 1 is b, a sub 0 is c. The subscript is just about, you know, making you aware of the fact that these are different values, different coefficients. But what we have here is that this term right here is equal to a squared and with a negative out front. A sub 1 here is equal to 0 times x. And here we have that a sub 1 is equal to 1. And here I have an x squared. So this is what we mean by x squared. That's a 0 term minus a squared. It just so happens that this plus a sub 0 is equal to negative a squared. There we go, negative a squared. So the middle term there is not represented. And these are very, very easy to factor. And they are easy to factor in as much as we're going to have x minus a and x plus a. Why is that so? Well, x times x, that's my x squared. And there's my negative a times positive a, there's my negative a squared. But look what happens to these two terms. I have positive ax, negative ax. And if I add positive ax plus negative ax, I get 0x. And so that middle term is gone. Let's have a look at an example. Let's have x squared minus 25. Now, is that a difference between squares? Most definitely. But please do remember, this is x squared plus 0x minus 25. It's just that coefficient there is 0, so we don't even put it there. And let's rewrite this. I can rewrite this as x squared minus 5 squared, because 5 squared, if I just look at that, 5 squared is 25. And there's a square, and there's a square, so these are going to be exceedingly easy to do. There's my x minus 5 and my x positive 5. So I'm taking the negative of this number and the positive of this number. There's my 5, there's my 5, there's my 5, the negative and the positive version of that. Because if I multiply negative 5 times positive 5, I get negative 25. But here I have positive 5x minus 5x. Those cancel out, and we're left with 0. Let's do another example. In this example, I'm going to do 25x squared. Let's make it minus 81y squared. Is this the difference between squares? Yes, because I can write 25 as 5 squared x squared minus 81 I can write as 9 squared y squared. And now I just have to remember, if I have a to the power n times b to the power n, that is just going to equal a times b to the power n. So I have the same power. There's an n, there's an n, there's a 2 and a 2. So I can just multiply these two by each other. That will be a 5x, and I'm squaring that, minus, and the same is going to happen here. I've got 9y, and I'm squaring that. Now I'm thinking of this as one term. This is one term. I have the square of this term minus the square of that term, and lo and behold, I can do what we've had way up here. So I just have to remember that it looks different from this, but it is still the square of something minus the square of something. The square of something minus the square of something. So this first one is 5x is my first something. And now I have to have minus the other one and 5x plus the other one. And so there's my one term and there's my other term. Whereas here I had my one term and my other term. here we go, is going to be this whole term minus this whole term and this whole term plus that whole term. So you can clearly see here the middle term, if I look at these two, they are going to cancel out. And all I'm left with are these two terms. And if you multiply them out, you're going to get 25x squared minus 81y squared. Good, let's have a look at some more. There is the difference between cubes. And so what we're going to have here is something like, let's make it a cubed minus b cubed. And this would be a, if this was an x, I would think of this as being a third order polynomial. And there is a very nice way that we can factorize this. This is going to be a minus b. And then I'm going to have a squared plus ab plus b squared. And this second term cannot be factored. We can't have any factorization of the second term. So let's have a look at an example. Let's have something like, let's do 8x to the power 3 minus 27. Now, once again, remember, this is 8x to the power 3 plus 0x squared plus 0 times x minus 27. And so that term is 0, that term is 0, and I'm just left with the difference between these two. And so when we write it like this, do not get confused. The only thing we're trying to show here is that we have something that is cubed minus something else that is cubed. This instance, I'm writing an example as a polynomial. It's a third degree polynomial. This leading coefficient is not 0. So it's a degree 3 or third order or a cubic expression. Now let's rewrite this. I've got 2 to the power 3 is 8 times x to the power 3 minus 3 to the power 3. 3 times 3 is 9, 9 times 3 is 27. And I just have to remember, just as we had before, if I have any number to the power n and another number to the power n and I'm multiplying those, I can rewrite this as a times b to the power n. So I'm going to do the same here. I've got 2x to the power 3 minus 3 to the power 3. Can you see I have the difference between two cubes, the difference between two cubes? And this instance, if I just look at a's and b's, there's my a is going to be 2x and my b is going to equal 3, positive 3, because that negative is right there. I'm just looking at the b part and that is my 3. Now I can look at this. So I'm going to say a minus b, which is going to be 2x minus b, which is negative 3. And then I'm going to have this term. So I'm going to have a squared, that's going to be 4x squared, plus a times b. So plus 2x times 3, that gives me 6x. And then b squared, which is 3 squared, which is positive 9. And that is the factorization of 8x cubed minus 27. And once again, this part I cannot factorize. There's no way that I can write this as, you know, two factors. Now there's a sum, or this, let's do sum of, and let's make that sum of, let's just say cubes. And in other words, I have a to the power 3 plus b to the power 3. And it turns out there's a nice way to factorize this as well. It's going to be a plus b instead of the negative. And here we're going to have a squared minus ab plus b squared. Once again, this cannot be factored any further. So let's look at a nice example. Let's do the same. Let's do 27. Let's do 27x to the power 3 plus 8. Can I rewrite this? Yes, 27 is 3 to the power 3 times x to the power 3 plus 8 can be written as 2 to the power 3. I remember the rule that I had there, so I can write this as 3 times x to the power 3 plus 2 to the power 3. And what do I have? I have a cube plus another cube, exactly what I have there. So in this instance, a is going to equal 3x, and b is going to equal 2. And so now I can just use this factorization. So a plus b would be 3x plus 2. And I have a squared would be 3x squared. 3 squared is 9. X squared is x squared. Minus a times b minus 3x times 2. That's 6x. And then plus b squared. So plus and b is 2. 2 squared is 4. And once again, we can't factorize that. And that would be the solution, factoring this sum of cubes. So look at the difference between these two cubes and the sum of these. Look at how these are done. And please do not get confused between there's a negative b there, negative 27. So the negative is there. And I just have to look at the 27 all on its own. So that's going to be 3 cubed. And now the very last bit of this foundational work in factorization is we're going to think about factoring rational expressions. Factoring rational expressions. Now, what do we mean by rational expression? What we're going to have is a polynomial. Polynomial divided by a polynomial. So let's have a look at an example. Let's have 2x squared plus 7x, let's make it plus 6, and we're going to divide that into x squared minus 4. Divide into that, I should say, x squared minus 4. So that is our example. I'm taking a polynomial, divide by another polynomial. And let's do some factorization. Let's factorize the numerator, and we're going to factorize the denominator. So this is another technique, or the last technique for this lecture that I want you to be aware of. So definitely here we're going to have a 2x, and here we're going to have an x. And we have to think about how on earth do we get to 7? Now hopefully, if you can, you know, if you think about it, let's think if we have a 3 getting to a 6, 3 times 2. If we have a 3 and we have a 4, and I can make a 7 from a 3 and a 4. Specifically, if I have plus 3 there and I have plus 2 there. So that I have positive 6, there's my positive 6, but if I look at 4x plus 3x, I get to 7x. So once again, you can write all these down, go through them one by one, but start thinking about doing these in your head. Here I have x squared minus 2 squared. That's the difference between two squares, and I know how to do this. That is going to be x minus 2, x plus 2. Do remember not to use the 4, not to use the 4 here. You have to write that 4 as a square. And the negative stands all on its own. So I just want to think about this 4, writing it somehow as a square. And of course, 2 squared, just this all on its own, 2 squared is equal to 4. And now I have the difference between two squares. So here I can put x minus 2 and x plus 2. And we'll remember from any kind of simple algebra is that if I have multiplication numerator, multiplication in the denominator, here's one term multiplied by another, or one expression multiplied by another expression, one expression multiplied by one expression, I can think about starting to cancel. And lo and behold, I have an x plus 2 and an x plus 2. So I can think about if I have x plus 2 in the numerator and exactly the same thing in the denominator, those can cancel and I'm left with 1 over 1, which is just 1. So those two have cancelled, and all I'm left with are these two. So that's going to be 2x plus 3, and I'm going to have x minus 2. So I've gone from a difficult expression here to something that's a much simpler by making use of factorization. So what we've seen in this last example for this lecture is, how can I make factorization work for me? How can it be useful? And here we've seen a beautiful example of how it can be useful. This would be difficult, and this would be a lot easier to do.